So I'm Julia Chapman. I'm a partner in the Antitrust Group. I'm based here in Philadelphia. And as Steve said, to kick it off, we're going to have our initial panel discussing how to win an antitrust case at trial. Emphasis on the antitrust because there are strategies, and we're going to talk about those today, that are unique to antitrust cases and really set them apart from other cases that go to trial. So roadmap for what we're going to talk about. First, we're going to talk about what kind of cases we're talking about when we talk about antitrust cases. What are the theories? Under what laws are those cases brought? Number two, and this is going to be the primary focus of the panel, we'll talk about the strategies that our team has seen work during antitrust trials, what has been successful from our perspective and what hasn't been. And then finally, we're going to take a few minutes at the end to talk about what we have all seen coming down the pike, what's on the horizon in terms of new antitrust cases or antitrust cases that are getting reanimated in 2023. So before we get started, if the panelists can, we can go down the line, briefly introduce yourself, and then we can get started.
Sure, thanks. I'm Sherry LaLue. I'm based in our Washington office. I am an antitrust litigator, first chair, trial lawyer. I've been doing this for 20-something years now, representing clients in all sorts of industries with respect to all sorts of antitrust claims, from your kind of standard price-fixing claims to novel Section 2 theories to distribution to merger challenges. So really enjoy the variety there.
My name is Jay Girata. I'm also a first chair trial attorney in Washington, D.C. I actually specialize my practice on antitrust issues dealing with technology companies. For over 20 years, I've had the privilege of representing Microsoft Corporation in multiple litigations, government investigations in both the U.S. and abroad. Other technology clients that I currently represent include Zillow, Sonos, and Panasonic.
I'm George Gordon. I think it's fair to say, and I think this is one thing that distinguishes our antitrust group, that everyone you see on this stage right now is a first chair antitrust trial lawyer and litigator. And so I think that's, you know, something that's a distinguishing characteristic of our practice. I spend most of my time, I've been doing this for 32 years, spend most of my time doing antitrust litigation and non-merger government investigations. Across the board in terms of types of conduct and industries, but with a principal focus on issues arising out of the enforcement of intellectual property, with a particular focus in the pharmaceutical industry.
My name is Melanie Tiltayara. I'm heading the antitrust group in Paris. I'm mainly a litigator, but in France we also do merger cases when you are an antitrust lawyer. I have a specialty in pharma and life sciences, but not only, because we are doing litigation in antitrust cases all over the board, be it cartels or abuse of dominant positions, mainly before enforcers, but also before appellate courts and also standalone cases when you want to litigate antitrust cases in France and in Europe.
And I'm Steve Bizarre. I'm the co-chair of the antitrust practice with Mike Cowie. I'm also a trial lawyer. I do antitrust trial work in the Section 1, Section 2 space, and also commercial trial work.
So, George, I'm going to kick it to you to start us off and kind of set the table. When we're talking about antitrust cases, what kind of cases are we talking about?
So let me just gauge the audience. How many folks here have either litigated or overseen the litigation of an antitrust case? Okay, so we've got some familiarity in the room, which is good. But just to kind of set the table for the kind of cases we're talking about, I really break antitrust cases into three buckets, and there's overlap, right? But three principal buckets. Their case is brought under, you heard Steve reference Section 1 of the Sherman Act. Their cases involve alleged collusion. That is agreements between competitors, typically, not always, to restrained trade in some ways, restrained competition in some ways that it would have existed without the agreement, right? So think price fixing cases. You're going to hear talk a little bit later on and also on the tech panel on some of the new cases involving kind of the use of AI and pricing algorithms and the use of Section 1 in that context. But those are Section 1 cases involving agreements. Section 2 cases, and it's also Article 101 in Europe. The second bucket are unilateral conduct cases. So these are cases involving unilateral conduct. They don't require an agreement, but they do require proof that the defendant is a monopolist or has a dangerous probability of acquiring a monopoly. So this is conduct by an individual company to exclude competition. Think some of the cases involving exclusive dealing arrangements where they're ubiquitous to deny competitors access to like raw materials or IP, think sham patent litigation and the like. The third bucket is merger cases under Section 7 of the Clayton Act and merger regulations. Now, the merger regulation in Europe. Each of these cases, each of these types of cases, and we're gonna be talking about kind of how we dealt with issues at trial in some areas that are specific to each of them. So obviously in an agreement case, one question is, was there an agreement? In price fixing cases, that's often the question in the case. In some other cases, like some of you may be familiar with the so-called reverse payment pay for delay cases in the pharma space, there is an agreement. There's no dispute about that, but the issue is, what was the effect of the agreement, if any? In Section 2, Article 102 cases about monopolization and unilateral conduct, the issue there, the unique issue there is the defendant a monopolist? Does the defendant have monopoly power, which is defined specifically both in the law and in economics? And in merger cases, I think one of the unique features of merger cases is that we're looking at crystal ball, right? It's not about what effect the conduct had, but it's predictive, right? What effect is the merger going to have on competition? But each of these cases also has common issues that we're going to be talking about, how we tried some of these common issues. Each of these kind of cases typically involves defining a relevant market. That is kind of what's the relevant competitive space that is involved in the case. What's the effect of the conduct, right? Well, how does that market work, real world? How do you prove up how that market works real world at trial? And what the effect of the conduct is, and whether the effect the plaintiffs are complaining about is due to the conduct or some other cause. And we deal with issues related to explanation of the conduct, right? So why? The why. The first question I ask in a counseling perspective when a client comes to me and says they want to do something is why? Right? Why? Is there a good reason aside from, hey, I really don't want my competitors to get access to this, right? And that's not necessarily the end of the analysis, but it often kind of gives you a clue. But how do you prove the why, right? How do you prove the why and tell a story to a jury or to a judge that's going to make you make them like your why, right? Because you want the finder of fact to like your why more than he or she or they like the plaintiff's why. So we're going to be talking about, for the rest of the panel, for most of the rest of the panel, how we dealt with particular challenges at trial in trying these cases that came up in the context of dealing with these kind of issues.
And so, and Sherry, I'm going to kick it to you to lead off. You don't start trial when you have a kind of final pretrial order and a trial date. It starts long before that.
Right.
So talk about your experience.
Yeah. Thanks, Julia. I'm happy to start, and I'm sure others will chime in. And apologies that my bag just fell. And apologies as I shift a little bit. I'm slightly incapacitated these days. But in any event, I think one of the most common and unfortunately one of the most costly mistakes that folks make is really thinking about trial as this long off thing that they really don't have to think about until they get to trial or, get closer to trial. And importantly, what is your story going to be? And it's really important, I think all of us believe, from the very beginning of a matter, any kind of dispute, to figure out what is your story and what are your themes and what are the key points that you're going to make.
And that's really important for a number of reasons. Certainly, although I'm sure everyone in this room would like to not go to trial, you know, if they're representing their client, in the sense of, you know, antitrust trials are very risky, especially jury trials. They are very costly, potentially with treble damages, costs, attorney's fees, et cetera. Sometimes you're not going to have a choice. But equally important is when you're planning for trial from the very beginning of the case, that informs everything you do, and it's important for motions practice and for educating the judge. I think sometimes, you know, particularly because antitrust presents a lot of complex issues that George was hitting on, you know, the market definitions, a lot of economics and other technicalities. We as, you know, our like geeky antitrust lawyers like to like really focus on those things, and we lose the narrative. And it's really important, judges are humans too, it's really important to why, to answer the why question that George was identifying. Get the judge to want you to win, right? And sometimes that means flipping the narrative. You know, plaintiffs, you know, assuming now primarily that we're on the defense side, plaintiffs come in with a narrative. They already have the judge with the complaint, right? And so we have to figure out what our counter narrative is from the beginning. Oftentimes that takes an investment right up front. You want to go straight to the motion to dismiss, but we always recommend doing a good early case assessment, you know, interviewing key witnesses, really finding out what the story is, looking at some key documents, and framing that narrative, which certainly will iterate through the course of a case, but you want to take the affirmative step in crafting your narrative, which then will allow you to really channel the discovery, which we'll talk about a little bit later, to set you up for any, you know, even pretrial motion, whether it's class cert, summary judgment, and then certainly for trial. And then, you know, once you get to trial, what you're going to want to do is, you know, take that record and put on a completely thematic, consistent story. And that's very difficult to do if you leave that to, you know, a couple months before trial. So we really, you know, think that you need to start that in the beginning in order to put on the kind of trial presentation that's going to win both the hearts and minds of the jury or the judge.
Yeah, and Sherry, I agree so much on the storytelling starting from day one. And, you know, I like to think about the closing argument even when you get that complaint and you're thinking about, sure, you're thinking about the motion to dismiss because antitrust cases tend to be good cases to get dismissed at the 12B6 stage. But you really need to think about, even in conjunction with your motion to dismiss arguments, what your arguments are going to be on the merits. And you know, what's interesting is that, you know, you were rewarded in law school for issue spotting. I think in antitrust cases, what you need to do is you need to get issues on the cutting room floor as quick as you can. I mean, you know, we love nebulous arguments like antitrust injury and antitrust standing. I practiced for 20 years. I still don't think I fully understand the law in that area.
Well,
and they're very defensive arguments. They make it look like you are hiding. And it's much better to kind of figure out what are the winning, as George said, what's going to make the judge or the jury think that your client is the good person and will want them to win, and then to simplify your story. Credibility is everything, not just in the courtroom on trial, but with the judge leading up to trial. And so simplifying your arguments, getting rid of arguments in the alternative, getting rid of arguments which make you look like you're inconsistent and you're just arguing whatever you might need to argue to win. It's I think in antitrust cases, it really is all about, it's all about consistency, it's all about simplicity, and most importantly, being credible, because many times you're not representing the most sympathetic defendants in the world.
Yeah. Just to echo what you were saying about simplicity, you know, even with, you know, obviously juries, I think everyone gets that you need to dumb things down, right? You need to simplify your story for a jury. But Article III judges, you know, a lot of them have not dealt with antitrust. There's a whole range of, you know, intellectual rigor. And like I said, they're humans too. And so simplifying the story, even if it is a complex,
you know, sort of geeky antitrust issue, the more that you can convey that in simple terms that the judge can get, the better off you're going to be. And again, that only sets you up better for when you get to trial.
And I want to talk about the record building and discovery, but I guess a question that I can open up to the whole group before we move on is, you know, the thing that I heard from both of you is you need to make sure you have a story that resonates, because not just a story lawyers can fall in love with, but a story that would resonate not with the trial team. Are there any strategies that you've used for pressure testing that story early on, before you commit to a record, before you get deep into discovery?
Yeah, I mean, sometimes, honestly, I will talk to other people, mm-hmm. and sometimes that's our colleagues who aren't antitrust lawyers, to see how it resonates. Sometimes I'll talk to my, like, freshman in college daughter, right, like, to see what resonates with her. I'm also a fan of doing, again, it's an investment, but doing some early themes testing, not a full jury exercise where you're doing, like, an opening, you know, a closing, and evidentiary issues, because that's difficult to do in the beginning, but really, and sometimes you can just do it online, but if you, get a good jury consultant and do some initial testing on themes, that can be so informative of, like, things that we think resonate don't always resonate, and it really can help you sort of shift your focus and help you build the record accordingly.
Yeah, it may.
I also think we are very, very critical of each other, of our clients, as a group, as lawyers, and there's tremendous value in developing these themes, in figuring out who's going to communicate the theme, who are the people that are going to be the who are going to carry the water for your client, who's going to tell the story. It may not be the person who's in charge of the business. They may not be temperamentally best suited to be the storyteller. And so I think there's tremendous value early in the case when you're doing the witness interviews, when you're working up doing your fact investigation, when you're testing your themes, to also be testing the people, the witnesses that you're going to be relying on, and whether they sort of pass the bullshit test, whether they're going to be effective communicators.
Maybe I can add something. In Europe, as you may know, we don't have juries in order to trial antitrust cases. Antitrust cases are mainly initiated by the regulators, although we more and more have these standalone claims before the judges. But then we have sort of professional judges or judges which are very familiar with commercial issues and so on. And so about simplifying the story in order to get a better attention from the judges or from the regulators is very important, especially because the regulator tries to put a very simple story in front of you. So you need to have a counter story which is as simple and understandable as the one which is presented by the regulators. And about cooperation within the team, what we have done, and this came to me, this initiative came to me by US clients, very demanding clients, who always asked to have mock trials in order to test the argumentation in front of lawyers from other law firms. So we have replicated the model, and we do these mock trials within the group with people who are not involved in the case, so that we get these reactions from a lay person who is not familiar, so that this person can present criticism in order to make the story more convincing and simpler, obviously.
One other just quick point that I'd like to make, and this applies certainly at trial, but it applies in briefing too. I think, you know, going back to don't miss out on the judge as your audience until you get trial, right? And he or she will still be there at trial. But, you know, every briefing, every opportunity that you have to put forward your themes, even if it's in a factual background, you know, whatever, repetition matters. I know sometimes we think, oh, repetition is terrible, but these people aren't living with the facts and the law and the issues in the case the way we are from day to day. So I think you really need to take advantage of that, you know, to keep plotting your story throughout the case history.
Yeah, I mean, I think what I've heard from everyone is, among other things, make sure that you don't create an echo chamber where, you know, you're not getting outside perspectives, or you're not actually considering the fact that the judge isn't going to be as dialed in, obviously, as the case team is. Sherry, you had used the phrase that it's important to channel your narrative through discovery. And I like that, and I want to transition to the discovery piece of it. And I want to open it up to the group, but I think discovery in antitrust cases is a massive undertaking. And I think one of the things that we see, because in many cases that discovery is happening in the context of a joint defense group, you're seeing other defendants handle discovery. I think one of the things that we see is this kind of defaulting to a very defensive posture in discovery, just fighting giving everything, fighting giving up witnesses, fighting identifying witnesses, and I'm sure we've all seen this, like just not wanting to give up anything. And obviously that's a key part of the strategy, but I think one of the things that our team has done well, and I want to hear everyone's strategies for doing it, is using discovery to affirmatively build our record and make sure that from day one of the case and then through discovery, we are building the record that will allow us to actually take the case to trial and not just fighting giving something up. So I guess, George and Steve, I'll flip it to you at first. Kind of with that in mind, not just playing defense, what strategies have you seen work?
I think it's important to understand the dynamic that's at play in an antitrust case. These cases take years to get to trial, years to resolve. At the start of the case, most of the defense group lawyers are super gung-ho. Everybody's pounding their chest. They're going to win at this stage. They're going to win at that stage. As the case goes on over a period of time, the threat of damages, treble damages, joint and several liability, and a plaintiff's expert with a multi-billion dollar claim can thin the herd. And a lot of the defendants are not going to be there come the trial. They are going to have settled for not insubstantial amounts of money, depending on their risk tolerances. And you're going to go to trial with a much smaller group of defendants. So from the very start of the case, you have to think about what you're going to do to preserve the testimony that you need. In a conspiracy case, that testimony is a refutation of the existence of the alleged agreement. And you have to think about how you're going to do that. You're going to not just do it with your own witnesses, but you have to do it with your co-defendants' witnesses, the other parties to the agreement. So what we like to do in our cases, and we do this in pretty much every single case, and sometimes it's met with enthusiasm by our co-defendants, and sometimes it's met with resistance, but we conduct friendly cross-examinations of our co-defendants' witnesses at their depositions to establish the absence of an agreement, to identify and foundate documentary evidence that we think, from their files, that we think is going to be helpful to us at trial. So it's an admissible form. And we do that across the board. Similarly, if our own witnesses are testifying, we want to make sure that at the end of their depositions, there is nothing that is ambiguous that would support the plaintiffs creating a triable issue of fact to get to a jury. We want to try to develop a record for summary judgment. We want to recognize the reality that 5 years from now, that business executive might no longer be an employee of your client. They might have been, they might have retired. They might have been reduced. They might have been terminated. They might not be there to testify at trial, and you can't assume that they'll be there. So you need to have their own testimony preserved and in a form that's admissible, not just preserved with leading questions, but in a form that's admissible, so you can use that at trial. At the same time, you have to think about the other key actors. George identified the importance of defining a relevant market. What are the industry characteristics? Is it an industry where there are important trade associations? Is it an industry where a lot of employees know each other personally, socially, or because they've changed jobs? Is it an industry where there are press, trade press, that actively interviews clients and reports on the industry? What can you do to go out and develop a record through those non-parties to try to establish that they were not acting as a conduit, funneling information from one defendant to another, facilitating a conspiracy, promoting a conspiracy? It's a very complex tableau that you have to manage right from the start to develop a record that advantages you, not just for summary judgment, but for mediation, for trial as well.
And George, you just lived this at trial. So.
Yes, yeah. So a couple points that, and one of which I want to put an exclamation point on what Steve just said. But a couple practical things. I think of the life, I think one thing that echoes what Jay and Sherry were talking about, that you need to think about from the start of the case, I think about coherence, right? You need coherence from the very beginning to the very end of the case in terms of your strategy development. Everyone talks about like a case that goes to trial, you win a trial. But Julie and I just tried a case over the summer. We won. We got a defense verdict. We won that case starting on day one 8 years earlier, right? Starting building our record, right? And the first thing, it's really easy during discovery to lose sight of your North Stars, right? I know there's only one North Star, but you may have more than one, right? So I still say North Stars. Right? It's really easy to lose focus because discovery is just like so spread out and just becomes like in the fog of discovery. So one of the things that we like to do is starting from the very beginning, make it, and it can be short, it's better if it's short, right? What are the key points of law and the key points of fact that you want to tell to develop the narrative that doing what Sherry and Jay told you, you've started to develop, right? And that's going to change, right? You need to be flexible, but you need to start. So when you're taking discovery, you're asking yourself, are the document requests that I'm propounding, do they fit with this? What document requests do I need to propound? What interrogatories do I need to propound? What depths do I need to take? How do I prepare my witnesses at deposition to support this story? Now, put an exclamation point on what Steve was talking about in terms of examining your own witnesses. In the case that I was mentioning that we had over the summer, the case went to trial 8 years after it was filed. By the time the case went to trial, not a single one of our principal fact witnesses were still employed by the company, and not a single one, well, with one exception, but he wasn't available when we needed him, not a single one of those witnesses were willing to come to trial for the company. So we had to try a three-week antitrust case without a single fact witness, live fact witness from our client. So how do we do that? Well, we did it in the depositions that took place years earlier, right? We went into each of those depositions with a fairly extensive outline of a direct examination. And it, you know, may not have been the full direct we would have done at trial, but it was pretty darn close. I mean, some of them were 90 minutes long, right? Some were 90 minutes. I think one approached 2 hours, right? We walked through, if we put this person on the stand in a somewhat truncated sense, what would we ask them, right? And so we played a lot of tape. The other nice thing, and so these are witnesses explaining why our client did what they did, how the market operates, supporting all of the experts that testified on, you know, the issues of market definition, how the market operates. We tried the case in the depositions, and that's one of the things that we do, right? We consider deposition practice to be trial. The other nice thing it did is we had a rule. We, you know, preparing for trial, we got into the order at the case management conference. Every witness's video was going to get played once, right? And guess who gets to go first? The plaintiffs. So the plaintiffs designated the video. We got to drop into their case our entire direct examination of our witnesses, right? So during the plaintiff's case, the jury heard our case, which was super helpful. You don't often have the opportunity to do that. So we take seriously the deposition, right? A lot of lawyers don't like to do that, right? A lot of lawyers, and something you should think about when you're working with your own counsel on your cases is, do you want to do this? Julie and I recently had a case where we actually noticed one of our own employees, still an employee. The plaintiffs had noticed his deposition, which we were happy about because we wanted to take his direct during deposition, and then they canceled the dep. Mm-hmm. So we went to our client, went to the head of antitrust, and we said, you know what we want to do? We want to notice him. We want to take his deposition because I don't know when this case is going to trial, and he's a great witness, and I don't know if he's going to be willing or able to come. So we did it. We noticed our own employee. Julia did, a 2-hour direct?
Yeah, about 3 hours.
Perfect trial direct, and now we've got it in the can if we need it for trial.
And we knew that we wanted his testimony because, kind of just to reiterate, going back to Sherry and Jay's point, we had spoken with him early on in the case, and we knew that this guy was a storyteller, and we wanted him to be able to tell that story. Melanie, anything from your perspective that's different?
It's pretty different.
Yeah.
Although there are similarities with respect, for example, that people, when the trial comes, are not anymore with the company. We have also this difficulty that more and more companies have this no document policy, so that they keep the documentation only a very short period. So when you need it, you need to have access to try to find a story to tell the regulators. You don't have access to the relevant documents anymore because they have been destroyed. But that being
said, that can be helpful too.
Well, not really, because sometimes the documents have already been seized, so they found other stuff.
Enough,
you see that for the defense argument. So because we are more in a public enforcement environment, so it's the regulator who is starting the whole process, be it through a down rate, because there was a complaint, or because they heard about something, they read something in the press, there's a leniency applicant. There can be different means of why an investigation is started. But once it's started, very often we have these down rates. And so your client or your company is down rated, but you are not the only one. You are all the companies which are suspected of having participated in a collusive behavior are down rated. So you will have access to the documents which have been taken in your company, but not the documents which have been taken in other companies. So you can do your own discovery with your own documents, see what have been seized. And when I speak about documents having been seized, I speak about thousands and millions of documents, you know, because they take the whole mailboxes of relevant people. And then they, at least in France, it's like that. At the European Commission level, it's a little bit more selective with keywords and so on, so they have less quantity. But the French authority, they just take the mailboxes over the years by the of the relevant people they have identified. And so you need to go through these documents, and you can try to build a story, but you do not know what is in the bucket of the competition authorities, because you don't know what has been seized at other companies' levels. And so we start interviewing people in order to understand the documents which are critical, and to try to start building an alternative story to the one we identify during the risk assessment process, what would be the story of the regulator. And the defense starts there. Unfortunately, we don't have this deposition system. I don't speak about the UK because, first, it's not anymore in the European Union, as you know, and second, the system is a little bit different. But within the European Union, most of the system are civil law systems, and we don't have this deposition system. So you cannot freeze the information, in fact. Yeah. So we try to do it in a different way. We interview the relevant people, we take notes, but it's own produced evidence, obviously. So we are facing these sort of challenges, and I know we don't have so much time. Oh, I can't speak about this for hours. So.
I think we all feel the same way, but I have very specific instructions related to CLE. So for those requesting CLE credit, the alphanumeric code for this panel is LIT101, and you'll need to provide it when signing out. Again, it is LIT101, and I think that's a good opportunity to move on to one of the other things that I know the panel feels strongly about, and that's the use of experts, both in working up your case and at trial. I mean, George had mentioned the trial that we had where we didn't have a single fact witness. We did rely heavily, necessarily, on expert witnesses to tell the story. And so I want to hear kind of about your take on that. And I know others have kind of maybe slightly varying takes on the use of experts. So I'll open it up to the group so we can hear those.
So, yeah, I mean, I think just briefly on experts, as Julia mentioned in our trial over the summer, we had to rely on the experts to tell the story. And so one of the things you can make sure you do when you select experts is make sure you've got good storytellers, mm-hmm. right? The best technical economist may not be the best expert. It's hard, right, when you're picking experts, but some of the things I ask experts, for example, if they're academics, do they teach? Who do they teach? Do they teach undergrads, mm-hmm. right? You want someone, I like to look for someone who is taught the kind of lowest level possible, who's distilled complex ideas in a really simple way. And also the second thing is not to have them do too much. We love, I think as Jay and or Sherry mentioned earlier, like antitrust lawyers love really elegant, complex theories, right? And economic models, right? Predictive economic models that are built on like 15 different assumptions, right? That can be death in front of a jury and in front of some judges, right? And in fact, you know, one of the things we were able to kind of leverage, I think, very effectively is our expert didn't do that. Our expert economist was an econometrician. So one of the things I could ask him on direct is, well, you're an econometrician, right? And I said, well, so why didn't you do a model? That's what econometricians do. And he was able to explain to the jury, well, because I relied on like real world facts. I looked at the real world facts about how this industry operates and how things actually transpired. And that's what I based my testimony on, as opposed to the plaintiff's experts who built like these Rube Goldberg economic models that were really easy to pick apart on cross.
Just to pick up on that, the credentials that we as very academic, well-educated lawyers tend to gravitate toward, Nobel laureates, PhDs from MIT, PhDs from Oxford, University of Chicago, University of California, Berkeley, don't always play that well with juries, and they don't necessarily guarantee acceptance by the judge either. I've had cases where Nobel laureate economists were cross-examined very, very effectively because they didn't treat the exercise in the courtroom with the same sort of rigor that they would have treated their academic work. And that's, you know, great for you when you're cross-examining an expert like that. Not so good for the plaintiffs if they're relying on an expert like that to make their case. And in our practice, in our antitrust cases, the plaintiffs need to use experts. The only way that they can establish impact, injury on all class members in a class action is with an expert who has a formulaic approach to that process, an econometric analysis. And it's highly technical, very, very elaborate sets of variables for and against. And you can devolve into a battle between two different experts with different views about the market and which variables are important. And it is mind-numbing. I think the jury doesn't understand it. The charts cancel each other out. The experts tend to not be very persuasive or effective. And the best storytellers are not necessarily the super credentialed, super technically sound economists. They are people who may not have gone to MIT, but are really good at communicating, really good at taking these complicated theories, these complicated models, and explaining them in simple terms, in accessible terms. And it's really important to choose your experts wisely and not to over-rely on them. In that regard, sometimes your best expert isn't a paid outside expert, but somebody from within the company. The federal rules of evidence allow you to use lay opinion testimony if you do it properly. And sometimes you may find an expert on an industry from within the company. And you should not be shy about exploring that when you're doing your early case assessment, when you're doing your witness interviews, about thinking about that and about putting in a report that gives you the basis for relying on a lay witness and having that lay witness offer opinion testimony in addition to the expert testimony.
And Steve, I actually have a question on that because I've seen you and our teams do that in a number of cases, particularly the kind of the lay expert. How do you bring that person who obviously is busy with their day-to-day jobs and might not have litigation experience, how do you kind of successfully bring them along for the ride and get them invested in the case?
Well, I mean, usually it's the selection, right? You select a person who's really offended by the notion that they conspired or their company conspired with some other company and should have to pay $1 billion times three to a group of plaintiffs who know nothing about the industry, nothing about the markets in which they compete. But then once you have identified the candidates for that role, part of it is keeping them involved in the case, updating them, telling them what's going on, cultivating them the way you would cultivate a paid expert, an academic expert. And then making sure that they have the time within, you know, their role when they have business imperatives also to address, but the time to address what you need for the litigation, and not dumping something on them at the last minute. And that all goes down, I think, to case planning.
Yeah. I agree with all that. I do think sometimes independent experts can be a real opportunity if they are chosen correctly, right? And this goes back to knowing your audience. And so even in looking at the credentials of the individual,
certainly you want a storyteller and someone who can relate to a judge and or a jury, but you might also want to think geographically, right? So if you're in, as I was not too long ago, the Eastern District of Texas, you probably don't want the MIT professor, right? You want someone who can speak Texan and who can, you know, give analogies related to Ford, you know, F-150s and, you know, really relate to the jury that or judge that they're speaking to. But it's another opportunity to go back to this sort of theme of our panel, which is this thematic presentation that you're starting from the beginning and pulling through. Because if you can have an independent expert come in and resonate some of your core themes and really echo some of the evidentiary points that you're making from your opening to through your crosses, you know, through every point of trial, that really can add, you know, an extra layer of credibility to your whole presentation.
I just want to echo one thing that just 2 seconds that, that Steve said, and just, you know, the personal relationship you develop with your fact and your expert witnesses, the ones that you think, and your lay expert witnesses, right? The ones you think are going to be really important, it's often overlooked, but, you know, again, these folks could leave. Right. And you want someone who you've developed a personal relationship with, who likes working with you, is invested, feels like they're invested in defending so that if they do leave, they'll be willing to come back. Right. Because you can't always guarantee that someone you work with in that role is going to be around 5 years later when the case goes to trial.
Yeah. So the first thing I'm doing when I get a call from a downrate of a company which is downrated, once we have faced the downrate, obviously, is call my preferred economist in order to be sure that he will not be conflicted and that somebody else does not take him on, because there are not so many of them who are really good in drafting reports which are understandable by the regulators, the judges, and so on. So it's very important. It's also important to have somebody with whom you can really communicate, who gives you the drafts in order that you can double check what he's saying, that it's understandable. Like, I take the position when I don't understand it, the judge will not understand it, so it needs to be done in a way which is clear. We don't have this, we are not very much used to use internal witnesses, because regulators, they do not give a lot of credit to those witnesses, except possibly on people who describe how a market is operating, because there they understand that the people who are in the company probably know best.
So, and I think, unsurprisingly, one of the things that we've heard from everyone is make sure the expert's testimony is going to be accessible, make sure that clarity is the goal. And just from a practical perspective, kind of again, focusing on trial, I think what I've seen in terms of a successful strategy is making sure that the actual trial team, and certainly not kind of the expert economist team in particular, has a hand in building the direct from day one. Definitely. So that you're not kind of fighting the anchoring effect of a direct that could be just absolutely brilliant and will go over everyone's head. And so we like to, and I like to make sure that if someone is sitting with that team building the direct testimony and not being handed something as we get close to trial. And I think that that's actually a good transition point to something I want to flip to you, Jay, which is kind of thinking early on about how we can make some of the complex things that the experts are talking about, or in some cases our own fact witnesses are going to be talking about at trial, kind of interesting and something that someone wants to listen to. Because, I mean, from my perspective, and I bet that this is shared, the most fun thing about being an antitrust lawyer is that you get to dive into industries and markets that you don't understand, and to do your job well, you have to learn the ins and outs. Mm. But not everyone has the same inclination or the incentives or the time. And so kind of that's where our head is as antitrust trial lawyers. What are strategies that have seen work for getting the judge or getting the jury excited about things that are really complicated?
Embrace the complexity through simplicity. I mean, it really is about, these are normally always quite complicated fact patterns or quite difficult issues. I mean, let's face it, you're not going to go to trial unless there are strong arguments on each side, and there's going to be a lot of nuances. And I think one of the most difficult things, because, I mean, you know, most of the people who are doing these cases are really smart people. And they understand complexity. And they've been living with something for years and years and years, which they're then going to have to present to a generalist who doesn't know much about this, be it the judge or be it a jury, and in a limited time frame. And so the key is really to resist the nuances. There are just factually correct nuances which don't really matter at the end of the day. And there's always going to be some tension in your story. And you've got to just think about what's the tension that we can live with, because it's not going to undermine the credibility. It's not that, you know, it's not that bad at the end of the day. You can read, you know, you can, you know, there's always going to be bad documents in any company. I mean, it's just the reality of it. You just sort of deal with those nuances a bit. And, you know, I like to think about it as the grandmother test. And, you know, Sherry referred to it. This is kind of like the cheap jury testing that you do is you talk to your generalists, you talk to family members, you talk to friends, and you just run these ideas by them, and that kind of helps you simplify the story. Graphics are really important. I mean, I spent the early part of my career dealing with computer operating systems and how they dealt with applications. and they all turned on this funny thing called an API, an application programming interface. Russ Cohen over there is laughing because he lived through this with me. And, you know, the whole notion is, you know, how does the software kind of work together? And how are you going to explain that to people? Well, someone came up with this great idea of plugs and sockets. Okay, which we all know because we've all plugged in lamps. And, you know, how software interacts with each other is very complicated. What these things do is basically an operating system, you know, reveals, you know, various code that applications can program to, and it's kind of a shortcut, and the operating system knows to print the document or knows, you know, so you're basically programming all these shortcuts and operating systems. And so we, by using plugs and sockets, you know, people could visualize how the application just kind of plug into the operating system, and then kind of magic happens, the same way that electricity is delivered, you know, in your house. And, you know, I couldn't tell you at all why the lamp lights up, but I know the lamp lights up when you plug it in the socket. And that, you know, that was really good for sort of getting those sort of things across. And, you know, finally, analogies. Analogies also are very good, and no analogy is perfect. But again, you have to resist your type A perfection. Focus more on what is going to convey the same idea simply in much less time and in a much more digestible manner.
Your emphasis on graphics, and I'll flip it to you, Sherry, I think is important. And I would also push for making sure that graphics don't become an afterthought that is just kind of on your final trial prep list, but rather, you know, there are graphic teams that I've worked with, I really like to work with, that can be hugely helpful, whether it's at kind of Daubert stage or summary judgment stage, because then one, they're learning the complex technology and then are better able to contribute as a team. And you can start playing around with what works early on and not at the last minute. But I cut you off, Sherry, something.
No, all I was gonna say is agree with all that. Analogies can be your friend, they can also be your enemy. And so you have to be really careful, and I would advocate for jury testing those too in whatever form you're jury testing, because they really can come back to bite you. But I totally agree, like making, you know, things into a real world example that people can relate to. And similarly with graphics, and this goes back to the expert conversation as well, all economists love their graphs. And they can be very effective in the right situation, but most juries are just completely lost and they just don't have the time to study them. So really figuring out what demonstratives to use with economists to get their key points across that juries can actually relate to. And that's another example of where, you know, little focus groups, however you form them, can be really useful, because most people are not used to looking at, you know, bar graphs and charts the way we are.
And Sherry, I would say that the last thing is, again, all these cases have problems. If you can't fix it, feature it. So I was doing a case a few years ago that went to trial where it dealt with HD radio, which is, you know, inside your car and plays radio kind of in high definition format. And the legal issues aren't important, but there was a big dispute on whether or not the radio was that infotainment unit in the middle of the car, or whether the radio was this little chip that was inside, you know, when you open up that infotainment unit, it was the radio, that little chip. And we did the jury testing, and people were hung up on the notion of, well, it's just this chip in the car. So this was a case, it's one of the few cases that I've tried, which is actually where I live. So I thought about, how do I convey this? And so I decided to start off my opening statement by talking about my drive to the courthouse and turning on the car. And I actually, you know, the song that played was Thinking Out Loud by Ed Sheeran. And so, you know, I heard that, you know, and I looked at the center console and it said Thinking Out Loud by Ed Sheeran. And then I took like our key witness, and what did we do? We actually opened up this infotainment unit and we talked through all the little things that little chip talked to, you know, in that box, and kind of embraced this. And the jury deliberated 20 minutes before they returned our client a complete victory on what we needed. So, you know, a good example of how your jury testing, which you should be doing along the way, really can influence what you do at trial, and you can actually, by embracing your weaknesses, you can turn it into a strength.
And I just want to emphasize something that Jay just said, which is the show, don't tell, right? Mm-hmm. Like the example Jay gave of kind of taking the actual piece of equipment and show the jury. Yeah. Right? Make it concrete. Actually, because, you know, people like that. It's hard to talk. It's hard to describe. It's even hard to graph. It's hard to put up the right demonstrative to show it. But you can actually show people. Say, look, here's, and I don't know this technology at all. But,
neither
you know,
did I.
Yes, sir. most effective witness expert I've ever seen actually was outside the antitrust case. It was a death penalty case, and we were trying, it was called an Atkins hearing. It was on whether or not the death penalty would be constitutional because of our client's developmental disabilities. We brought in a neurologist to explain to the judge, it was a bench trial, to explain to the judge some of the brain damage that this person suffered. The neurologist, first of all, he loved his job, made him a great storyteller. He took out his model of the brain, right, for the judge, and started like taking it apart in front of the judge and explaining each part, like where, why the damage here mattered and how that affected development. And the judge was just enraptured, right, because he didn't just tell, he actually showed the judge.
I think, kind of, and this is a good transition point for what's next or what we expect to see, something kind of in the context of you know, embracing technical complexity that you're starting to see more and more in antitrust cases, and it's actually kind of a longstanding practice in products cases and some IP cases, is this concept of a tutorial day or a science day. And you know, Jay and I are involved in a case in which the judge just had one, and you know, that could be a long conversation in and of itself. But I think the important point there is figure out if this is something that you are going to want very early on and start conditioning the court, kind of, this will be useful, this will be helpful, this shouldn't wait until summary judgment, and kind of have that as a target. So it's kind of a question to ask as the team, would we benefit from kind of a dedicated science day or market day or whatever you want to call it for the judge to start diving in and understanding these issues? So just under 10 minutes left, we'd promised that we're going to talk briefly about what we see on the horizon. Melanie, I'll start with you. Anything kind of interesting or particularly interesting, I should say, coming down the pike in the EU?
Yeah, maybe a few bullet points. We see a development of a plaintiff bar in Europe, not only follow-on actions, but also standalone actions, especially when a plaintiff does not get a sympathetic ear from the competition regulators. They can then decide to go before the court and trial their direct private enforcement case. So that is something which will probably be more and more developed in the future, because competition authorities now don't have the obligation to follow a complaint. They can just decide that in an opportunistic way it's not of interest for the common interest of the economy or of the country with respect to that particular case. We also see a lot of work going on at the European Commission level in order to modernize some of the enforcement texts. For example, because of the evolution of the society with remote working, which is more and more developed. So they are adapting their procedures in order to be capable of finding the evidence in people's homes. And we also see, obviously, more and more interest of the European Commission in digital and green transition of the economy issues. They are very interested in tech and still in pharma, obviously. So these are the sort of trends I can summarize very rapidly.
So I'll open it up to the broader panel. What are we seeing? What's exciting, concerning, both of the above going into 2023?
So one thing that we hear a lot about from the current administration is the tech platforms and the interest in the administration has in pursuing claims against large tech companies. I think it, like a magician who sometimes uses a misdirection to hide the ball, What people are not understanding, and we have a panel about this as well momentarily, is that there's going to be a lot of attention paid on labor and employment conditions. And I think that one of the big areas for growth in the coming year, as has been the case in the past couple years, is the labor markets. No poach agreements, non-competition, no hire agreements, wage fixing, all the things that affect workers' salaries and the freedom to work are going to be very, very important and prioritized by the government enforcers. And of course, where the government goes, the plaintiff's bar goes as well. So,
another area, I think, and I know I see a number of patent lawyers in the room, I think we're going to see continued and expanded attacks on the exercise of patent rights across a number of industries. I mean, if you read the DOJ's recent comments to the PTO on their initiatives to enhance the robustness of the patent prosecution process, you can certainly sense a frustration at the antitrust division, and I know this is shared by the FTC, about kind of existing ways to attack under antitrust law the exercise of patent rights. So I think we're going to see some of the new and novel theories trying to kind of plow new ground and really maybe even get involved in trying to affect patent law in a way that it will make it more difficult for particularly dominant companies in an industry to get patents on their products. So I think we're kind of, the pendulum swings on the antitrust treatment of patent rights. I think we are swinging back to an era of kind of enhanced enforcement.
And, you know, Steve kind of referred to the attack on technology companies. Everyone knows that, you know, Google, Amazon, Meta, you know, Apple, they've been under attack for several years. Well, I think what you're going to see is that's going to continue to other not as large technology platforms, and that you know companies that serve as platforms where other companies interact with that platform, but maybe the platform owners has other products that work on that platform, that sort of self-preferencing, you're going to see that kind of go down the waterfall to smaller technology companies, and there will be arguments that they are dominant in these really narrow areas, and self-preferencing is going to be a bad issue, which creates an issue for those companies, but it also creates an opportunity if you are a company that relies on someone else's platform and they're taking action in a way which makes it harder for your business, there will be more opportunities to basically go on offense and use antitrust in a way to get a concession which will be helpful for your business.
I think that's a really good point, Jay, because this has been, to some extent, defense. We've had an emphasis on playing defense for good reason. But, antitrust being used appropriately as an offensive tool to address meaningful competitive concerns, not new, but certainly something we're seeing a lot of. And on the platform point, I think one of the things that I think has been interesting is, when you hear what the DOJ, the FTC are saying about platforms in particular, there's some, they're kind of, What you hear is, hey, we're going to throw out the old rule book. We need new rules for these markets, and which kind of creates a decent amount of uncertainty. And I think it's interesting that they're recognizing that maybe the rules that we've had in place for a long time aren't going to work for their enforcement theories. Anything in particular you want to add, Sherry, before we wrap up?
Offense, which takes a couple forms, is you know, one thing we've seen is companies being willing to be plaintiffs, and that comes in various forms, like Jay and Julia were talking about. Sometimes there is a real business concern and a legitimate claim. We've also seen a lot of opt-out action by sophisticated companies. Companies have gotten a lot smarter. Legal departments have realized that they can be a revenue generator and not just a cost center. And, you know, that sometimes even if you are able to defeat a class as a defendant, that's not necessarily, certainly not necessarily the end of the day, and not always necessarily better when you have, when your putative class is full of big power buyers and you're going to get, umpteen million big opt-out cases. But even when the class is certified, we've, seen a lot of opt-out activity, and I expect to see that continue.
Absolutely.
Yeah, certainly, litigation funding and the availability of litigation funding makes that a lot easier. The lawyers who would represent these opt-outs or these power buyers can be funded, at least in part, while still having some skin in the game. And that also just highlights how important it is when you're doing your discovery in the case to anticipate the possibility of these large class members, these absent class members, maybe later, if you defeat the class, becoming individual plaintiffs, and to think about how you would target them for discovery, either as an absent class member or later as a plaintiff, so that you've built a record to address that if the class is denied.
Yeah. One other thing, and I don't know if it'll become a trend, is this, there's been a couple of recent cases, including one pending now that we're involved in, but is the notion of private plaintiffs pursuing Section 7 under Clayton Act, challenging mergers, like sort of in parallel with the government investigations.
And before we close out, and this goes to kind of what's already, or it fits within, I should say, what's already been discussed about kind of a target on tech, I think, early 2023, and I think this is going to ramp up, you started to see a targeting, both at the DOJ and in private actions, of algorithm-based or AI-based use or pricing software and markets' use of that. And kind of the fact that, market participants use this type of software as itself sufficient to trigger an investigation and state a claim. And that's kind of ubiquitous, I think, and so something to pay attention to. But we are at time. Thank you, everyone. This was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for sitting with us.
So don't forget to scan the QR code and complete the affirmation evaluation web form to get your credit.
So we're going to have a 10-minute break, and we'll be back here, or not here. You'll be at your designated breakout room at 10:15.
Tech is to your right.